It's my pleasure to introduce Bassem, who you all know as a past president of the society. You know, has a great experience with tumor therapy, and I'm sure we'll see some more great cases. And please hold your questions until when he's done.
Thank you, Alan. Over the last 4 or 5 years, I got very interested in doing more of the malignant lesions, and I'm going to share with you kind of a little bit my experience, but also more important, where we stand in terms of treatment of malignant compression fractures, and where we stand in terms of combining both augmentation and radiofree and ablation. If you go to any textbook for treating malignant compression fractures, you will not see the word vertebral augmentation in those textbooks. The treatment of malignant metastatic lesions of the spine is either medical or radiation or surgical. And the medical treatment is either chemotherapy or pain management procedures or steroids for cord compression, radiation therapy, and surgical treatment. Surgical treatment is mainly for radioresistant tumors, for cases that's unstable, for cord compression, and for progressive neurologic deterioration. But where is vertebroplasty? Where is cement stand here? Well, we all know that we do augmentation for two reasons, for pain management, because we control the pain, and also for stability. Let's go through those different types of treatment and see how or where cement augmentation really stand for or fits in that paradigm. Radiation therapy, it's the most common treatment known, has a long proven record of pain relief. There's up to 70% of neurologic improvement, but it takes more than 3 months to restabilize the vertebra. And it's not good for cases where there is impending collapse. Recently, radiosurgery had been introduced, especially for renal cell metastasis and for radio-resistant tumors. You can see this is the early experience from MD Anderson. Only they had 41 patients, and they had a good results of about 80%. And this is an example for a radiosurgery, not just a standard radiation that we do. Here is a lesion that you can localize under MRI, and you transfer the images for a CT, and then you direct the, this is a very high dose in a single setting, and treat the lesion. Same patient had also lesion in the sacrum, and they did the same thing. They localized the lesion and delivered very high dose in one session for that lesion to treat it. And this is the treatment slides for that lesion. So when you look at radiation, it does control pain, but it takes long time to work in terms of stability. And it is really a vicious circle, because when you have a tumor, the tumor causes pain by distension of the bone under the periosteum, but also cause instability, and the instability can cause pain. So it's like a vicious circle, and if we really want to treat those patients, we have to stop this circle. Stability is a very important thing in those patients. This patient had a T5 fracture from breast cancer, and this is how she looks like 4 weeks later. So it's like a 50% decreased height in 4 weeks. So this is a very important area that we had to address in those treatments. So let's look at what we know about stability from our radiology teaching. We all know the columns of Dennis, the anterior and middle and posterior. If you look at the surgical literature about stability in tumor cases, they actually, the surgeons will divide the vertebral body into a 27 cubes, and really depends on where is the tumor is that will have treatment and the stability. So if you look at those cases, and let's look at this example here, where this patient had lost 9 cubes. But on the right side, the 9 cubes are in the middle, in the left side, and directed perpendicular. So that patient is completely unstable. This patient is actually stable. And we know from our cases, even for benign lesions, when you have a big cleft, when you put a cement in that big cleft, the patients do very well. So that model actually works, and we have to be aware of it if we really want to do a targeted treatment for tumors. In other literature, they actually divide the vertebral body into six different parts, and they say that if you have three or more segments involved, this means that the lesion is unstable. And this is very important for us to know if we need to do a pedicloplasty in our way out, or if we put cement here for a tumor or cement here. So this is why we really, if we need to address those cases, we need some kind of a targeted treatment. So what I call it a smart augmentation. We're just not putting cement and getting out. We need to know exactly where the cement needs to be placed. And it makes sense that you want to put it more anterior because it's away from the cecal sac if you have compromise of the posterior wall, and also if you have an epidural extension. And makes more sense because they stabilize the anterior column that affect the stability of the lesion. Not to mention that if you have a patient with a big lesion in the zone 3, which is anterior two-thirds of the vertebral body, the patients need corpectomy. The surgeon to fix him needs to go anterior and probably also go posterior to fix that lesion. But if you have a patient with tumor in zone 1 or 2, probably the surgical treatment will be only posterior. So why we mention that? Because it's really important that if you have a smart augmentation or a targeted augmentation, you can alter the surgical management. You need to replace this picture with this picture if you have a way to control your cement to deposit in the same way like this cage. This way, this patient will not need this posterior stabilization, or even if you need to put posterior instrumentation, you can avoid the bigger part of the surgery for going anterior. So where we stand in 2011? We know that augmentation for malignant lesion does work. We have the CAFE study from kyphoplasty, but there are so other studies available. We know that the complication rate in malignant lesions are 4 times more common than benign lesions. We know that 6 cement will decrease leakage, and I have a paper I'll present, I think, on Friday about that, that if you actually use a 6 cement, your leakage rate in benign and malignant lesions are almost the same, doesn't change. And we know that there, if you add some kind of ablation or coblation, it will add value for the cement augmentation. Well, the 3 ways of available now for clinical use in the United States is coblation and radiofrequency ablation and cryo ablation. Now, why you would consider doing ablation for tumor even before you put cement? Well, if you look at the cadaver studies, there's a couple of papers that they showed that restoration of the intact vertebral stability is actually possible with metastatic vertebra after 30% of tumor ablation. That's big thing when you make it the vertebra more stable by just taking 30% of the tumor. They also found out that ablation therapy adds to the benefit of immediate cell death, controlled lesion size, and thrombosis of the intravertebral venous plexus that can actually eventually avoid distal metastasis. There is a couple of other cadavers that showed that creation of a cavity in a vertebra will allow a preferential cement to position in the region affected by the disease and facilitate restoration of the stability of the involved vertebra. We had a tool that used to do a coblation by Arthrocare, but there were some issues with that tool. One is the amount of tumor debulking. The tool was very weak in terms of how much energy it can develop and how much tissue you can remove. It was not flexible, so you're really limited of one side or one location because you can't move the spine wand inside the vertebral body. However, by using that, we know that it allows more control over the cement deposition. And you can actually control that you can put your cement in the anterior two-thirds of the vertebral body in most of the cases if you use this tool before you put the cement. And it may actually lead to less leakage of augmentation. However, with this tool, you cannot use 6 cement. And this was one of the papers that was published about the coblation. So this was a kind of a treatment paradigm that I published in two years ago in the ASNR. Basically, It's very simple. If you have no cortical disruption, if you have no epidural extension, you can use a conventional vertebroplasty or kyphoplasty based on what you want, what you're comfortable with. However, if you have a cortical disruption and epidural extension, I would use the coblation because this way I can have more control over my cement deposition in the anterior two thirds of the vertebral body, not really tumor debulking. Now, if I have a paraspinal soft tissue extension, you know, you can use an RF or cryo augmentation before the cement. And that matches the pathological classification of tumors in the vertebral body, type 1 and type 2, which is most of the lesions involved in the vertebral body with no destruction. That's conventional vertebroplasty, kyphoplasty. Type 3 and 4 and 5, where you have epidural extension, use the coblation. And in the extraspinal stuff, we use the RF and cryo. Now, not to mention that in Europe, there's completely different experience. Dermond, who invented the vertebroplasty, had treated cases with actually neurologic compromise. So you have patients with coda equina and multiple myeloma, and he will go in and treat them and had very good results. Jacques Chirasse, also in France, he likes to use very liquid cement, which is completely opposite of what we like to use here, but he injected in a very long time, and he tends to fill the whole vertebral body with liquid cement. This is his experience. So what we are missing today? Well, we're trying to find a stronger RF probe so we can really do a tumor debulking. We need a more flexible tool so we can have some kind of a targeted treatment. We want to know where we put our cement. We need to have more control over the heat generation and heat deposition because we don't want to hurt the spinal cord, and we need to avoid, we need to use thick cement. And also, we still need to know a good algorithm where and when to treat different options, when we can use radiation, when we can use radiotherapy, where we can use augmentation. This is a technology that's coming probably at the second half of this year I would like to share with you. And it's the same defined system that provide RF enhanced or RF thick cement can use the same box that generate RF to use an RF inside the vertebral body. And this is the flexible osteotome. So basically it's a second generation where you can have a probe at the end where you can generate radio frequency. And the good thing about that is you have more energy you can deposit, and also it's flexible. So now you're going to be able to go to the anterior part or the posterior part or the left or the right with that flexible equipment. This is how you can direct it from outside by moving the RF active zone. It has a lot of safety parts of it, like there's a proximal thermocouple and distal thermocouple that actually they will stop the heat deposition once you reach a certain temperature. So that adds to the safety of the procedure. This is what's going to happen, what's going to be in the future. You have a distal tip of active electrode and proximal tip of active electrode. You have a kill zone, and you can move it from one side to the other or from one part to the other of the vertebral body. Now, you have to remember that we in 2011, we put stents with that have active drugs on it. We didn't reach that point 20 years ago. We started by putting balloons, and then we put stents. Now we have stents with drugs. So probably 5-6 years from now, this is probably going to be obsolete and have something more advanced and something more better. But, you know, we have to start in some place. But this is going to be definitely a big step forward on how we can have a targeted treatment for vertebral augmentation. These are cadaver models where you can see, we can control completely the kill zone. This is the spacement where you can see the ablation track, and this is the tissue necrosis, and then the hemorrhagic zone around the kill zone, and this is how it looks like in the future. And this is again another picture of the instrument.
A little round for my two colleagues who did an excellent job. And thank you, DFine, for providing us lunch and the opportunity to discuss all this. So thank you, DFine.